చూడు వస్తుందా ఓకే గుడ్ ఆఫ్టర్నూన్ ఎవ్రీవన్ టుడే వాట్ వి ఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు సీ హియర్ ఈజ్ అబౌట్ సిసాట్ in terms of analysis, in terms of your preparation strategy and the marks required and the number of questions that you need to attempt and so on. First of all, just like with any other paper, let us start with the syllabus that is given in UPSC prelims notification, right? When we are looking at the syllabus, so I have just noted it down, the six topics that are there in the syllabus. So first we will look at what exactly each of them means, and then that will give you an understanding about how your preparation should be channelized, right? So the first thing that we need to understand over here is comprehension. Now, as the it indicates, comprehension, it has no particular thing that is attached to this. That means it is mainly the reading comprehension questions which are given in bilingual, just like any other UPSC questions. So this is what I would like to clear in the beginning itself for those who are going to appear for the first time. All the questions in UPSC, whether it is in prelims or mains, are given in both languages, that is English and Hindi. Same is the case with these comprehension questions. So the comprehension questions are given in both English and Hindi. So these are, the name itself tells you that reading comprehension, a paragraph is given and below that there are certain set of questions. It could be a small paragraph having one question or a big paragraph having 4 to 5 questions as well. All of them are being asked in UPSC. So that is the first thing. Secondly, the interpersonal skills. These interpersonal skills and also interpersonal communication, and also there is questions based on your understanding of certain English language, or rather the way the questions are communicating to you. These interpersonal skills demands an understanding of the language and also what the author is trying to convey. Over here, as the name itself indicates, that is interpersonal. That means between two people, or between more than two people as well, how the people are communicating, that is what it is. The questions based on interpersonal skills are relatively very, very few in the exam. However, it is a part of the syllabus, so we need to be prepared for this. And the next one is logical reasoning. As the name itself indicates, this logical reasoning. This logical reasoning questions are various type of, within this logical reasoning, there are 2 to 3 different types of questions. Under this, I will tell you, you need not make a note of it, but just for your understanding, I am giving you this classification. We can say that these reasoning questions are logical reasoning, that is, as mentioned here. Another one is analytical reasoning. Analytical reasoning is mainly what that you come across, wherein you will try to look for possibilities. Like there could be more than one possibility from a given scenario, and you are trying to analyze which one is correct. When you think of this, what comes to your mind, at least the basic thing that should come to your mind, is the seating arrangement. People are sitting around a table, or a circular table, or a, let's say a square table, and so on. So that will analyze the possibilities, that is analytical reasoning questions. And the other one that we have, that is common in UPSC, is graphical reasoning. So there is no topic as such in graphical reasoning. If you look at any material that you have been referring so far, you may not find any graphical reasoning topic as such. However, in UPSC prelims, UPSC does ask some questions based on this graph, so which can be classified under graphical reasoning. For this, you don't need any specific preparation. It would be sufficient if you can, when you are going through your economic survey or like any other science books, NCERT books, when you are preparing, if you can go through some of the graphs, that should be sufficient. Nothing more is required. And the next one is logical reasoning questions. Logical reasoning is, as the name itself indicates, there is a logic. So mainly based on statements, or let's say a small paragraph is given, from that you are trying to conclude something. So it can be any of them. That is logical reasoning. Next you have these decision making questions. Decision making and problem solving. So I would like to mention one or two, a couple of things about this decision making. The decision making questions have been, they have not been appearing in UPSC for the past 4 or 5 years. As you all of you are aware, CSAT started in 2011, right? See, I did not go into the history and the detailed explanation of each of them, because we don't, due to paucity of time, I do understand that you have only 50 days to go for prelims, so I am not taking much time into this, I am just brushing through the things. These decision making questions have not been appearing in UPSC prelims so far. However, you can go through a couple of things in that, so that would be beneficial to you. That's it about decision making and problem solving. Problem solving as such, you might be a given scenario and then ask you to find out a solution for that particular problem. But of late, in the recent past, they are also not appearing in this one. Another speciality about decision making questions is that, as given in the previous years by UPSC answer itself, there are more than one correct answer. That is, two correct answers that are there, and UPSC in the answer key that they were providing after the process is over, they were giving two correct answers for this. And also there is no negative marking for this one. So which means that if you attempt and even if you get it wrong, there is only zero, there is no negative mark in this. That is the speciality of decision making questions. But unfortunately, we are not getting any of those questions right now. And the next one is general mental ability. That is, see, when this, what this tells you is that general mental ability, it simply tells you that you don't need any sort of syllabus or preparation for this. However, a bit of practice will be very good. General mental ability means it does not involve any formula. It does not involve any structured learning that we have seen, like let's say 6 to 10th and so whatever you must have read. So that is not required as such for mathematical questions from general mental ability, right? So these general mental ability questions, I would say, you know, the simple question is like, you know, giving a cube, wherein a cube is given and all six sides are given, which side is opposite to which and so on. Or you try to arrange the six numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 on six surfaces. So then answer the question as to which number is opposite to which number. So on and so forth. We are not getting into the details that we will see in classes, but this is the basic about general mental ability. Next one, and people generally, you know, that generally most of the people say that I am weak in this CSAT is because of this one particular topic, that is basic numeracy. Basic numeracy means, as I did not write the complete paragraph that is given in the syllabus, it also involves basic numeracy, that is numbers and their properties, data interpretation, data sufficiency and so on, that is given over here. And at the end it is given that it is up to class 10. I would like all of you to make a note of this one, that the basic numeracy is up to class 10. In fact, it is not even up to class 10th, I would say it is up to class 8th only. That is why, if you remember, I think you can remember very well that a couple of days back I have sent you the syllabus or some of the topics from 6th, 7th and 8th standard NCERT maths book, because some of the, most of the topics are directly from UPSC and some of the questions have already been asked in UPSC. So that is why I wanted you to learn about that. That's the main thing. Since it is clearly given that it is up to class 10th, you need not even worry at all, right? However, there will be some tension, like, you know, I may not be able to follow this, or I may not be able to do this and so on, right? We will try to allay all those fears, you need not worry. So we are here to take care of that. Now, the next one is, in this again, I would like to say that even up to class 10th, there are some chapters which are not involved in this. That means which are not a part of your CSAT. For example, statistics. Statistics is not a part of your thing. Of course, we do read a bit of statistics up to class 10th, it's not required. Algebra, geometry, that is properties of triangles and so on, that's not required. Basic geometry about circles and this is what is asked, and nothing more. Even in mensuration, the basics of, I don't think any question about, you know, that cylinders, spheres and all those stuff have been appearing in this one. Again, the basics. After that, and trigonometry, which we read in 9th and 10th both, it is not a part of this one. So the first thing I would like to tell you is that don't worry about this maths that is appearing in CSAT. I mean, we will see with a couple of examples in the video as well, or else through the classes when we are doing it. But most probably, the chapters that we are seeing will not be appearing at all in the CSAT paper. There was one more syllabus topic that was there earlier. It has been discontinued after 2014-15. That is English comprehension. English comprehension means that the pair, it is trying to test your English language skills. Therefore, the questions or the pair of passages are given only in English and not in both English and Hindi, right? However, this has been discontinued following various protests that have happened back in 2012, 13 and 14. You must be aware of that. Even if you are not aware, you need not be bothered about this because that's not there in the syllabus. The syllabus is this. So these six are the only topics that you need to prepare as far as CSAT is concerned. I hope we are clear on this one.
Right.
Now, moving forward, I will just try to go further. Once you understand the syllabus, next we try to understand the how the questions are being structured, what are the, you know, number of questions that CSAT paper consists of, and how many should we be targeting to answer, and so on, right? Now, for easiness, we will go one by one. Like, first we will see. Now, let's try to understand how, you know, why, how should you prepare, or rather, how should your approach be? Now, first, let's try to understand, just like paper 1, see, even paper 2 has 2 hours of time, which means there are, 120 minutes to attempt 80 questions. Number of questions is 80, and number of marks are 200. Now, this is a simple equation, 2 hours, 80 questions, and 200 minutes. And now, you already know that qualification mark is 33%, and 33% of 200 is nothing but 66 marks. Right? All of you are aware of this one. We need not be unnecessarily, you know, looking more than this. Now, if you look at this, 66 marks out of 200. And how many marks does each question carry? 80 questions, 200 marks. Which means each question will carry 2.5 marks. Clear? So each correct question, if you are attempting it, each question will carry 2.5 marks. If you attempt it correctly, you will get 2.5 marks. Suppose that if you go wrong in attempting that question, so that wrong attempt will give you 1/3 of wrong marks, right? You are aware of that one. So 1/3 of the marks that is allotted to the question. So each question is 2.5 marks, 1/3 means minus 0.833. So this is the positive and negative. So which means, now I think you can do simple calculation in this one. Based on this calculation, you just see, for you to get 66 marks, you should get, how many questions correct? Can you calculate this? You should get 27 questions correctly. That's it. This is what you need to get. So if you have to get 27 questions correctly, now how should you be doing it, or how many questions should you attempt? 27 questions you should get correctly. That means, do you attempt only 27 questions? No, which is obviously not. So it clearly tells you that you need to attempt more than 27 questions. So more than 27 questions means even 30 will not be possible, because even if you get one or two questions wrong with negative marks, you will not get the correct. Now let us say I am attempting something like 40 questions. So when you are attempting 40 questions, let us say your accuracy is 80%. 80% means 32 questions correct and 8 questions wrong. 32 correct and 8 wrong. So if 32 questions are correct, you will get 80 marks minus your 8 questions are wrong. So your 8 questions are wrong means 8 into 0.833. Right? So that will take it something like, you know, if you are taking 8 questions wrong in this one, so 8 questions wrong means how many marks will be deducted? Approximately 7.5. Right? It's not exactly 7.5, I'm just taking it as 7.5. So which means you will be getting it as 72.5. So, and then you will be clearing it quite comfortably. That is the goal, and that is the agenda with which we'll be looking at. Nothing more than this. If you are getting anything more than 75, that's bonus. So we are not worried about it. But you should not be getting less than this number. That is the thing. Now you might ask me, sir, why are you insisting like, you know, 75 or 72.5 when the cutoff is only 66? Now, for those of you who have given any competitive exam, especially for people who have already given civils prelims, both in paper 1 and paper 2, I am sure you must be, you know, going through various keys. When you are going through some keys, let's say in one key you are getting 32 correct and 8 wrong. And suppose in another key, you are getting only 30 correct and 10 wrong. If you are getting 30 correct and 10 wrong, now you try to do the maths. This 30 will give you 7.5. 10 wrong will give you something like 8 or 8.33, or this mark will be deducted. So then you will get something like 66.6 or 66.8. So which means, So you will get 66.6, which means, so you are just one more question, just half mark above the cutoff or half mark above the qualifying mark, which will give you very big headache when you are preparing for your mains, because unless until you are sure that you are clearing the cutoff, it will be very difficult for you to concentrate on your mains. That is the main reason why I am asking you to target something like 75 or above 70 rather than 66. That's the thing. And this is what you need to understand, otherwise it will be very, very difficult. I am sure, you know, people who have already appeared, especially in GS, I am sure whenever you are, let's say you are referring to Institute A, they are giving different answer, different key, and Institute B is giving a different key. And finally UPSC comes up with altogether different key, which, in which both A and B institutes were going wrong. That is why it becomes a problem. And that is why the goal should be something like attempting somewhere like 40. With 80% accuracy. I hope I am able to make sense here. Now, another thing that you need to understand, that am I asking you to stick to 40? If you are able to attempt more than 40, that's fine enough. No one is stopping you from attempting, you know, more than 40. But minimum that you need to attempt is 40. And the minimum accuracy that you need to have is 80%. Which means, out of every 5 questions, you need to get 4 correct. Even that becomes a bit of problem sometimes, and that is why we need to increase number of attempts. So now I hope you are clear on this one. So now I am running this, so I am taking the questions forward. Now if you see, if you are not able to attempt 40 questions with 80% accuracy, therefore we may not be able to clear cut off. That is why you need to increase the attempts to something like 40. I would say with 45 questions, with something like, let's say, between 70 to 80% accuracy is the ideal scenario for most of the people who are having some problem with CSEP. That is the main concern here. So, as you can see here, I am trying to concentrate mainly on CSEP for those people mainly who have not appeared in CSEP so far. And secondly, people who have appeared and have a problem in clearing the CSAT or have some worries about clearing the CSAT. These two are the people I am trying to concentrate here. I hope this is clear up to now. Now, so, and also please remember, due to the time or the approach, I am talking strictly in terms of, you know, this risk reward or time reward analysis. We are just, how much time we are putting and what are we supposed to do here. See, with some preparation more, you can attempt 50 or 55 questions and you might get, let's say, 100 marks also, but that's not our goal, because you need to get only 66. If you are getting 100 without much effort, that, you know, than what we are doing here, that's fine now. But if you want to put more effort to get 100 or not, it doesn't make any sense. And above 66, whether you are 66 or 166, it doesn't really make any difference. In fact, it does not make any difference. It's not about any real difference. There is no difference at all. Because ultimately, you will be clearing the prelims based on your GS score if you are here 66 here, right? So now, once that this is clear, so the funda is very clear here, you need to attempt something like 45 questions with 70 to 80% accuracy. So if you are at 40, you need to attempt with 80% accuracy, that's fine. So 40 to 45. Now again, come to the maths. Now you have to attempt 40 questions and you have 120 minutes. Which means, again, you are having 3 minutes for each question. 3 minutes for each question. Now, so if you already appeared for any competitive exam, signing the sheets or attendance sheet and all these things, and also going through, see, if you are attempting 40 questions, doesn't mean that you will read only 40, right? So you have to read all 80 questions. That I will come when we are dealing with strategy, but since that it has come up, I will tell you, if you are coming out of a competitive examination without reading all questions, that's it. You have lessened your own chances of clearing the exam. Always remember, you have to read all 80 questions. Whether it is in GS it is obviously 100, or in paper 2, it is 80 questions. You have to read. And out of that 80, you need to choose 40. That is the skill here. It's not like, you know, you are reading only 40 and doing that. Choosing that 40 questions out of 80 is what, you know, makes you clear the exam, not just solving 40. Which means that for choosing and reading other questions and all, let's say another 10 to 20 minutes will go. So finally you will be left with something like 100 to 110 minutes. So now if you do the same calculation to calculate the questions, you will have something like 2.5 minutes to solve each question. So that's the final thing. So for each question you have 150 seconds. 2.5 minutes means is 150 seconds. That is how you should do. See, always understand this basic maths. Why we are doing basic maths on CSAT syllabus also, or attempting also? Because that's what is our essence. We are not here to, you know, do calculate all the questions, unlike in GS. Like wherein you need to maximize as much as possible so that you clear the exam. Here it's not necessary. Over here, what is necessary is to make sure that you are passing that 66. Here we have a target, whereas in GS we don't have a target, we don't know. So maybe at one time 98 is good enough to clear the cutoff, and another year maybe even 110 was not good enough. For example, in 2016, so the cutoff was for general category, it was 116. So even 110 was not sufficient. So that is how you need to look at it. So now, eventually, so I think the basic analysis has been done now. You are clear. 40 questions, 40 to 45, each question will have 2.5 minutes. That is our goal. How should we go about it, and what are the areas that you need to cover, and so on, is what we'll be looking at. I just noted a couple of points here. So what are the things that we need to cover in this? So that's what I'm going to do now. So now we have gone through the syllabus, we have gone through the number of questions that you need to attempt, accuracy and the time for each question. I hope all of this is clear in this one. Now, having seen all this, let's move on to the next. So we have seen all this, so we realize that you need to attempt something like 40 questions and so on, right? So now let us look at how could you attempt 40 questions. Suppose if you are given any of the previous year papers, which questions you could have attempted to clear this particular cutoff, right? So now I would like you to open a graph or open a photo picture that I have shared you regarding the analysis of CSAT, regarding the question paper analysis of CSAT that I had given in various questions, previous year papers, right? So this consists of, I had taken it from one of the websites, so you need not worry. This is the photo. And so where, you know, how this classification is given. If you go through another classification, maybe it will be slightly different. But broadly, that remains the same. So first I will read this, what are the things that are written over here. So as it is written, the first topic is maths and basic numeracy. So basic numeracy. So that's what I am writing here. Next is logical reasoning and analytical reasoning. Basically reasoning. Another one is reading comprehension. And the last one is decision making. It is, see, as you can see from this, from 2014 onwards, no decision making. So I am just skipping that. So I will just write it as decision making, I will leave it. And then the last one is data interpretation. See, this data interpretation in some analysis people club with reasoning or basic numeracy. I would like to club it with, let's say, reading comprehension.